Hello, hello everybody. Are you having a great Pycon UK? Great. Now, I want everybody to stand up. Everyone that can stand up, stand up. I want to put your arms in the air. Shake them. Shake your legs. Get all that lactic acid out. Keep standing. Now, today is Friday, and Friday means Friday Club. And we're going to do something completely silly that the people who come on Saturday and Sunday won't know anything about whatsoever. So are you all ready? I don't think you are ready, but we're going to see what happens. Now, Wales is the land of song, okay? So I'm going to attempt to teach you a Welsh song that I don't even hardly know myself. And we're going to attempt to sing it, those who are willing to sing it. It's the only Welsh song that I could find that wasn't a hymn. Or wasn't offensive in some way, but this is a traditional Welsh song. It's only I'm a kind of English Anglo-Saxon, so I kind of give it a pass because, you know, it is about, after all, killing all these evil English coming over. But that being aside, it's a great song. So everybody's got to pretend they're Welsh. So think real Welsh thoughts, okay? Put your hand up if you're Welsh. No, everybody, put your hand up. Put your hand up if you're Welsh. Thank you. Brilliant. Right. Now, everybody remember that the first line is "Men of Harlech, stop your dreaming," okay? And I am going to... Oh, close VLC. All right. Are we ready? Wait. I don't need to make it smaller. I'll just make that smaller. All right. Are we ready?
Let's stop your dreaming. Can't you see the spirit?
Right, get the first verse, get the tune.
See the warrior pen of sleep.
Roll your R's. It's a bit of a rush. Okay.
Men of Harlech, stand ye steady. It cannot be ever said.
It's quite interesting, actually, because we English never did manage to conquer Wales, so we just appointed the Prince of Wales as our king, which works perfectly fine. We did the same in Scotland, couldn't conquer the Scottish, just made King James into our king. So I think that's why there's lots of pictures of Prince Charles around this place. Right, so sometime in the conference, I want to sneak that in and just randomly start singing it. And the other people who come on Saturday and Sunday would have no idea what you're doing whatsoever. Right, on to more serious matters. Right, let me get this right. I have to remove my VGA cable. And magical man with the remote control switch to HDMI. And we should have Luke with... Is Luke's... Yes, Ubuntu. And off you go.
Hello, so I'm Luke and I'm 14 years old. I came to Pycon last year to the kids' day and I enjoyed it and got a lot from it. Then later on in the year, I heard that the BBC were giving micro bits to people. But then I found out I was to the year sevens and was really disappointed. And then later in the year, I persuaded my dad to let me come to Pycon this year. And so now I'm here. All I brought with me was my laptop and my phone and my charger. Then we heard that they were giving away micro bits and I was really excited. So I managed to get one, and my dad got one, and I'm borrowing his. So I got my laptop out and my phone's micro USB cable and started programming one of the micro bits. And I made a calculator, which was fun. But then I saw that upstairs, JP Morgan were giving away battery packs. So I thought, oh, if I use one of them, I could use two micro bits at the same time as each other. So I did that. And so on one, so I wrote two bits of code, one for each. And one of them had the calculator, but then it sent the results to the other micro bit. So if you went in a math test, you could cheat. So one person would have one micro bit and work out the answer, and then the other person could see the answer. So I'll just demonstrate that. So can you hold this? Okay, hold my microphone. Yep. So if I... Oh, is it? Okay. Do I have an extended display? So here I have one micro bit. If I plug this in. And the other one. So if you see here, if we select a number, so do you want to pick a number to be our fastest number?
Five.
Okay, so five. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And what operation do you want?
Let's do multiplication.
Okay. So we'll multiply, and by what? So we get our answer. And then if we go to this one, we can see that it has an answer. My cousin's husband, Simon Davey, told me I should try and make Connect Four, so I'm going to try and do that tonight. So if you find me, if I've done that, I'll show you. Thank you.
Okay, remaining lightning talk speakers. That was less than 3 minutes, so that's how to do a lightning talk. Yeah, but you all have 5 minutes, and in order to make it work, I'm afraid, at 5 minutes, the screen will be switched. Right, have you got the next one? I'll reset the time. Yeah, perfect. So, I need to give the microphone away. I've got two microphones. I'm keeping all the microphones.
I think I might stand up because I can't see it.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Can you
okay. Right, and when you're ready, I'll begin.
Hi, so you can see what I'm going to talk about. What happens when you turn an iterator inside out? What I want to share with you is something that I've some interesting connection between two very different patterns in programming that fascinated me, and it's just a little quirky thing. My name's Stephen Pascoe, and my information's there. Right, so what happens when you turn an iterator inside out? And first of all, why isn't that responding? Just a moment. Oh, of course, I'm going to click on that. So what's an iterator? We all know what an iterator is, yeah, you know, we can feel confident about that. What you have something that's iterable, like a list or a set or whatever, and you create an iterator with the iter function, or it does it automatically in a loop, and then whenever you want a new value, you call the next function with it, yes? And you can keep doing that, and you get more values and more values. Okay, and this is great because you can put loops inside loops, and it's really sort of the staple of imperative programming. We're going to have to be a little bit more precise here because it's not only a value that can come out of this next function, okay? If we're really honest, there's three different things that can happen. You can get a value, or it can stop in the way these things normally stop with a stop iteration, or it can make some other sort of exception that we'll want to deal with differently, yeah? So what we're going to do is strip away some of the syntax here, which I'm afraid isn't Python, but you know, I hope you can follow it. Let's just take away some of these names so that it's all just one expression, okay? So we're going to imagine that there's only one thing you can do with an iterable in this, with thinking about these interfaces. You can call it to get an iterator. There's only one thing you can do with an iterator. You can call it and you'll get one of three different values. Okay, and in each case, that's a call with no arguments, yeah? Or we could just write it as all this one expression here, yeah? Which, if we go to the next slide, I know. I'll explain. So that's just saying there's something that you call that gives you something that you call which will keep chucking out either values or a stop iteration or an exception. And now we're in the position to do our magical transformation to turn it inside out. All we've got to do is reverse the arrows, okay? So this is what we had before at the top. Let's switch the arrows around. And that's not very readable. So let's just print it all the opposite way around. And now we've got this. Now, what on earth does that mean? What does it mean? Well, what we're saying is we've got a function that takes another function as argument. And that second function, which is the thing in the middle, you give it a value, or stop iteration, or an exception, and it does something. We don't know what it does, because it doesn't return anything interesting, but it does something, okay? So the final thing to make the connection is to realize that if you've got a function that takes one of three different things, okay, you could replace that with three different functions. Because inside it, it's going to have to decide what to do in each of these cases. So they could be three different things. And then you've got this transformation, where you've got three functions that just take a value and do something, yeah? And whether it's emitting a value, or just, I've finished, no more values, there's no need for any inputs there. Or handle my exception for me. Now, people that's written this sort of stuff before might recognize these. They look just like event handlers. They are basically event handlers. So if we put it all together, now, so there's a paradigm about this that I haven't seen much in Python, but is getting really, has been getting quite a lot of attention over the last couple of years in other languages, and it's called observer observable. Yeah, so we can call this tuple of functions an observer, because it observes something happening, yeah? And each of these is a push-based event that sends you the information instead of continually pulling it out of the iterator. And similarly, you wrap it all up and you have to give the observer two of an observable. And in Python terms, there's something called RxPython that will do this. You define three push-based methods, and then you just subscribe to it. So I've just said observable here. It could be a sort of push-based list or a series of events coming from your keyboard or from the network, yeah? So the same thing that I wanted to get, the sort of take-home message, is this is what's been called reactive programming over the last couple of years. There's something called ReactiveX, which I'm interested in. The reason this is a lightning talk is because I haven't actually used it much before, but I don't care that it's super trendy, but I think it's clearly, this way of programming is clearly going to become more important in the future. There is a Python implementation. I'd be interested in hearing anyone who's used it or interested in using it, but they are just iterators inside out. So, and I think you could say that more about, how long have we got?
Done.
I'm done. Okay.
Down this way, then. Yeah. Unless you're not ready, then we can go. We switch to two. Yep.
Oh, fine. Okay. My talk is about Python and open data. So, and it's been about geospatial open data. So the main source for geospatial open data is, of course, OpenStreetMap, which is a kind of Wikipedia for maps, which means it's by volunteers contribute to OpenStreetMap and put ever more details on the map. A few years ago, now the UK government did a big push in for open data, and the ordnance survey data was opened up. which had a lot of information. Also, the Department for Education gives us all the information about their schools. Same does Scotland. So when we put it together, we get from Ordnance Survey 29,000 schools, and from the Scottish Education Ministry and EduBase, 47,000 schools, which, when we plot all this information on a map, looks pretty much like this. That looks great. We could just import it into OpenStreetMap, couldn't we? Only a few little problems. The data sets don't quite mesh up. You can see that there are schools without any, or sometimes the schools are a little bit, both data sources disagree where the schools are and how they are named. The data may be out of date. Or sometimes the data is just plain wrong. Here, EduBase and Ordnance Survey agree there is a school. OpenStreetMap says that there is a graveyard. And when we look at the satellite imagery, yes, it is a graveyard. I wouldn't want my child go to there. So my employer gives me a bit of time to do fun projects out of my usual line of work. And so I came up with this. This is a website, map.uk, map.uk. If you want to contribute, where we actually now can crowdsource the information from both the sources into OpenStreetMap and make OpenStreetMap better and maybe even give back to those ministries with the more correct information. Here around Cardiff, we see 229 schools in a 10 kilometers or 6 mile radius. And it's relatively good map, so I had to wait around. So this is what it looks like when this tool finds an unmapped school. So the blue thingy is the data from Ordnance Survey, and down here I have my EduBase data, and all I have to do is click this button, and I am taken to OpenStreetMap. It's already submitted to OpenStreetMap. My geometry is there, and all the metadata about the school is there. All I have to do now, what's left is to do it manually. I have to make that building what was just plain building before, and say the building is a school, and it has a name. Of course, here, all open source, all open data. Feel free to contribute, or just to take away that code and build something similar out of it. Thanks a lot.
Right. What are the rules again? I've forgotten. One finger when there's a minute left. And two fingers when we're 30 seconds left, is it? Okay. So to help the speakers, when it's I'll give you a proper timer as well. So when there's 1 minute left, I'll start going like this, and you join me, okay? Just to be sure. All right. Whenever you're ready, we can begin. Is it loving you? You use the up and down buttons. What number is it? That's on.
It's number 3.
Number 3. Yeah. Can you put it to VGA then? Sorry, you have to be promoted onto lectern.
Other side.
This is all going wrong. That's right. We can come back in a minute if do another one if it's Right, you have to press a button as well. Yay. Okay. Right. Just speaking to this. And then, let's want the microphone.
You have to go. Hi, everyone. My name's Nicola. I work at IBM, and I'm quite tall. If you want to know how tall, it will cost you a chocolate bar. So what I do at IBM, and why am I talking about reloading things? Well, I work on OpenStack, and OpenStack is awesome. It never, ever goes wrong. It's brilliant. 2017, year of OpenStack on the desktop. I'm absolutely sure of it. So I work on OpenStack. I do a lot of Python there. OK, yeah, OpenStack is great, honest. So we love OpenStack at IBM. There's lots of people think OpenStack is the future of hosting, going over to cloud, running things on demand. It's all great. But we do have a problem, and it pains me every day. And it's called Jenkins. Oh, I'm not alone. Great. We can all meet up and have a cry together later on about Jenkins. For those of you who don't know Jenkins, it's this huge monolithic Python thing, which tries not to be monolithic, but actually is. And what it does, it watches for changes in code and then runs tests when it sees changes in code. The problem is we want to roll out our Jenkins automatically, and we want to have Jenkins just pick up new configuration changes and changes to plugin configuration and new plugins and downgrading plugins and all that stuff. So the ultimate irony is Jenkins is hard to automate. We looked at lots of different CI packages to do the integration of OpenStack code. Some of them were just too big, really good, but too big for our needs. Some of them were based on Zope, and our team doesn't really like Zope, even though I think some parts of Zope are great. So we copied Bender from Futurama and said, we're going to make our run. It's all going to be completely reloadable at runtime and have all the code reloadable as well. So here's a really cool trick, which you might not have seen in Python 3, introduced in Python 3.4, and it's part of importlib. So this is code from our plugin manager. And what happens when we tell the admin interface to reload, it loops through all the plugins it has loaded and reloads them. So any code from those plugins that's already running just carries on running. But the next time those plugins are called on by new jobs or new bits of code importing them, it will get the code that's been reloaded from disk. So we can load new plugins, we can upgrade them, downgrade them, remove them, install new ones, whatever we want, and we do not have to restart. And it saves us, literally over the course of a week, it can save us a couple of days downtime. Because when you're testing OpenStack, it can take hours. And to issue a restart to Jenkins, it has to wait till everything's finished. And that can take at least a couple of hours. So this code is up on GitHub. The CI system we've called Spoony Bard, because I'm a huge geek. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, everything's under Not Anarchy. Thanks very much.
Okay, I've just been told an amendment to the rules that like 20 seconds before the end, we do that, not a minute. It would have all been explained with the video that Harold sent us, but unfortunately I ditched that to have the micro bits, so we'll get Harold's video tomorrow. Next, who's next? Great. Off you go, whenever you're ready.
Okay, sorry. I'm a bit nervous because we know, or at least I know we're being watched, so I want to tell the truth anyway. The thing is, thanks for being here. I know you all want to hear this, not because of Python, the truth about aliens on Earth, as you may expect it. So let me tell you a bit about how I found this. I work at Machinalis. I'm a web developer there, but we do a lot of data-related projects with different data sets of natural language or transactions. But the most, one of the most interesting data sets, or the ones I like, are about satellite images, because you get to look at pretty pictures, and you see things like this, and you can see that the Earth is beautiful. That's why the aliens want it. And, well, while I was looking at these kind of images, I found things like this. So you see there's the circles, and what's happening here, this is proof of aliens on Earth. So now, what I had to do is collect some information, quantify the evidence. So I asked my colleagues, data scientists in the company, the people who do a lot of artificial intelligence, machine learning, complicated stuff, to help me how to track these aliens down. And these are very smart people, so they gave me some good advice. The first thing that they told me is that I want to help, which is what I was asking to them. And then they give me the official excuse. So I know they are into the conspiracy now because they told me, and I know they work for the CIA or the KGB or the PSF or something like that. However, they point me to the right direction and gave me the key on how to do this. So I got some high resolution images from USGS. That's freely available. You need to sign up and request a picture of any place of the Earth. They take 1 to 3 days to process the request. That's when they erase all the UFOs so you can see them. But they hide it and they send it a set of different images, one per each spectrum band that they measure. And I was looking for scenes here near Cardiff, but I couldn't find any aliens around here because you guys have the doctor who protects you. But I found this one in South America, which is where my family lives, and I wanted to know if they are actually being brainwashed or mind controlled or anything. So Jupiter is amazing. I got to write this code using the geospatial data abstraction library to load the files and map latitude and longitude and convert everything to 8-bit values to simplify a bit. It's a very little amount of code. And then with OpenCV, there's a lot of shape detection algorithms like host circles that allow you to actually detect circles, which is what I wanted. And once that's done, I can find circles in several layers and merge them and figure out which are the most important one. And I get something like this. There's a lot of things to improve, like removing circles in urban areas or in clouds or stuff like that. But I know using this I can find the truth, so if you want to help me, let me know. That's essentially all that I had. If you want to take a picture of the material, that's here. And thank you very much for listening to me.
Very good. Very good. Very good. Now this one at the end, which is number...
Hello everyone, this is Amit and I'll be speaking about Soldier. So first of all, a quick survey. How many of you have used subprocessors module in Python? Okay, I'm at the right place now. So I want you not to use this. So these are the various functionalities of subprocessor module. It spawn new processes, connect their input outputs and get the status codes and a lot more. So there's an OS module in Python, which also does a lot of things, like OS.system, spawn. So subprocessors module was written to remove these things and have a separate module for doing these stuff. So the goal of subprocessors module is to remove these things. And the goal of Soldier is to remove subprocessors module. So let's see what subprocessors does and, of course, how it does. So to run a terminal command, this is how you will do it. So the API is not that good, actually. So if you have to copy, so you'll have to pass 3 strings, that is CP, then the from directory and to directory. And if you have to move, you have to do the same. So it's like a random list of strings, then you have to pass. So I don't know why it is like that, but it is. So let's see another example. So if you want to check the output of the command, this is how you'll do it. Let's see some more examples. If you have to run some command line instructions and call it, so this is how you'll do it. Check output, check call. And if you want to run a different process, you'll just have a list of that process and make shell true and pass some random arguments, which I don't understand what is it. So if you want to kill a process, you'll again have to call the OS module. And this is how you'll do it. You'll just pass the process ID, and I don't know how you'll find the process ID. So also, if you want to run this with sudo, so also you have to pass the password at the runtime, because there's no way to have the argument as sudo. And if you want to have a timer to a process, and there's no way you can do it with subprocess module. So now comes the soldier to the rescue. Let's see how it does. So if you want to run a command, check output, get status scores, this is how you will do it. So there's only one object, that the current path is basically the soldier object. And if you want to get the output, just call the method around it. And get the status code, just a simple method call. If you want to get the process ID, and if you want to run a process, just simply process name and background is equal to true, and it will start the process without no shitty arguments. And if you want to kill it, just simple command dot kill. And if you want to check if it's still living or not, just is small is live. I think I should make that a property. So to run a command on sudo, you can just pass the password as sudo as a keyword argument, and it will run. It will not ask you for a password at the runtime. And of course, you can set timeouts on this. You can choose various options that you want to kill on timeout or not with a simple keyword argument. And for all this, thanks to my friend Yash Marotra. He wrote this library. I'm not the author of this library. He just told me to promote it. That's why I'm speaking here. Feel free to follow him, and thank you.
Okay, thank you. That was brilliant. Right, assuming I can count, we've had six lightning talks with two to go. Is there anyone else I said was doing a lightning talk and is on the board and I haven't had? We've had six, right? Good. You're next.
Thank you. Hi. My name is Gabriel, but I just prefer to go by G. It's shorter, and you know, I think we all know the alphabet, so I think it's a bit better. So I will not be giving a technical talk, but rather just telling you what we do. I'm from Namibia, and in 2015, we actually hosted Python Namibia. And then in 2016, we were lucky enough to be accorded Pycon status. So that was amazing, and we held it from the 25th to the 29th of January. Next year, we are planning a PyCon Namibia 2017, and I'm hoping to see a whole lot of you there, because we made it all the way here. I'm sure it's not that far. Thank you. So there, right there is Namibia. It's not too far away. It's only like 10 hours by flight from Heathrow. Namibia actually has a population of about 2 million people. And it's the third least populated country in the world. Now, for those of you that know the exact size of Germany, it's exactly about 2.3 times bigger than Germany. Yeah. Now, it's very easy to get there. So all you have to do is simply just head down to South Africa. And just before you get there, just turn right. Yeah. So these are some activities that we held at Pycon Namibia 2016, and those dapper-looking gentlemen, they're actually school students. And over here we have Samuel Antonio. He was a final year computer science student last year, just helping them out with Python. Something interesting, Samuel Antonio actually wrote his final year thesis on queuing theory. I didn't understand a word, but it was amazing. Some mathematicians in the house. Okay, also we had Jungle Girls, and then we had 32 participants for Jungle Girls. Of them, we had some from South Africa, from Nigeria, and from Zimbabwe as well. Now, we didn't just concentrate on Python, and we looked at local developers and what they were using as well. So we looked at things like PHP, Java, mobile developers, and a whole lot of other stuff. I'm sure Daniela showed a picture of me giving advice on hippopotamuses. Now, we also had some news coverage to promote the event, and here we see Vince and Jessica at the national broadcaster. And then we have our celebration. That's what we call celebrities in Namibia. We call them celebrations. So that's Daniele on NBC. And this was actually prime time, hey? It was morning time, so everybody got to see him. We had a packed program, and it's amazing how much you can get done in a few days. We're only showing the program for 2 days, but it was very packed. Take my word for it. Now, we also had lightning talks. The funny thing is here, we have a few countries represented just in this picture alone. So we have the UK, I think we have England, we have South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe, and Canada as well. Just in these few people that are right there. And USA, sorry, oh my God. Sorry, guys. Yeah, and then we, out of the PyCon conferences, the outcomes are, we actually have PyNam in Namibia, which is working with schools and students, more so learners, exactly, going out, creating out awareness about Python programming. And I think Jessica, if she's somewhere here, she's going to give an amazing talk and some of the outcomes of PyNam. And now we also have Django Girls all over Africa. Zimbabwe just had their Django Girls a while back. They are also going to be having a PyCon conference later in the year. There's a PyCon conference happening in October in Cape Town. There's also another one in Nigeria that is planned for this year still. So if just a little Googling and I'm sure you'll find them. Now, Namibia is a democratic country where unexpected things actually happen. This was actually on one of the few days that we wanted to have the conference and the students locked down the university. But the good thing is within 45 minutes, we're actually able to get another venue, catering, AV and support, and all thanks to some of our amazing sponsors. So you will find that Namibia is familiar but different. And we have a whole lot in terms of modern, this is actually one of the most famous pictures you'll find if you Google Windhoek. I'm going to rush through the rest now because time is flying. And then we have here the Trans-Kalahari Highway, which actually connects Namibia to Botswana. And this is a picture of lovely Namibia. And then if you see in the background, it says sand. If I spoke to some of you, you can do sandboarding there as well. Yay. Ah, it's almost time. So that's the URL. Thank you very much.
Really good. Thanks so much.
I hope you like the cat. Might just take me a sec for to get Google Slides up. So I'm David. I've been living and working in Wales for the last 2 years with the Office for National Statistics. Sounds terribly dull, but we have actually had some fun and we're doing some Python and some really cool things on the web. So just bear with me a sec. Right. So, please don't be alarmed. I haven't actually asked anyone permission to do this, so if I do offend anyone, please don't hurt me. But I hope you'll get something interesting out of this. So, the onus, I think it's fair to say it's been described in the press. Their website was terrible, and so the opportunity came up to build a new one, and where better place to do it than Wales? It's incredibly sunny, and it's a fantastic country, and I really love being here, so much so that I've moved in. So it was a tough challenge, but thank you, GDS, for everything you've done. We literally stood on the shoulders of giants. None of what's been done to ONS or with ONS could have been done if it wasn't for GDS. So big shout out to you guys, and if you haven't talked to them, go talk to them because they're great. The other shoulders of giants is the wonderful DevOps tools. There's so much that you can do with automation now. The amount of productivity that you can get to actually put stuff out onto the web reliably, repeatably, quickly, is just fantastic. So here's where the ONS started, and I hope you won't mind the flippant comment here. They had, there was an information architecture of 5,000 nodes. So you had 5,000 places to go to look for spreadsheets, to open them up, to find out if it was the data you wanted. And people were not having a good time with this. And you couldn't search for anything, you couldn't find what you wanted. The user experience just wasn't optimal, shall we say. So in the true spirit of iteration, we actually did iterate. So over a period of about 18 months, we started here, and here, and here, and here, and you can see it gradually gets more colorful and more interesting. So we actually put out a public alpha to get some feedback at this point. That went incredibly well. We were absolutely bowled over by the response. And finally, we've now gone live with this. So if the Wi-Fi is holding up and you open up ons.gov.uk, you'll see effectively my baby running up there. And the key thing is here you've got data right there on the front page. So if you want to know about the UK, ons.gov.uk, you've got what you want to know, and this time the search really works. So it's a website, right? Who cares? I mean, other websites are available. So the real point about this is the data. So this is about, it's not just about making a nice website. This is about making an API first, about exposing the UK's national data so that anyone can access it from anything that can do HTTP. And I think that's really cool. So this is where it gets really fun. So this actually is the ONS website, and I think that's awesome. I feel a little bit like that about it, and my colleague feels a little bit like that about me feeling like that about this. So if you're feeling curious, if you go to the ONS website, you'll see that what your browser has downloaded is a JavaScript application, and it connects back to this API to pull in the data. So what you see is a client of the API. And so when you actually go in, when you look at the UK's national data, it's coming straight off that API, and the visualizations you're seeing, that's actually coming straight from the API. So I thought I'd do a little montage reel, because actually we did have some fun while we did this. It wasn't all work and no play. We had an absolutely fantastic team, really lovely bunch of guys, both from the ONS and my team that I brought in. Really just got together, got stuck in. And a lot of happy times, a lot of hard times, of course. We actually moved into a bunch of flats in Cardiff. We kind of cooked and had dinner together every night. It's a really nice way of bringing a team together. And we had a few good evenings with it as well. So definitely not all work and no play, as you can tell. It got a little bit out of hand. So what did the statistics community think of this? They were extremely excited. It looks a little bit jokey, but if you take Brexit as an example, there's an incredible organization called Full Fact. They get paid for nothing. They check everything every politician says. And the fact that we had an ONS website that allowed them to get the data, it allowed them to do their job and get the facts out about Brexit. And I feel quite proud about that. I was just bowled over. I was like, why are these people interested? This is quite cool. The guy actually running the project got to go to Buckingham Palace and had a little chat with the Queen, which I was just, wow, was that us? I don't know. So really, it was just down to the team. We just had such lovely people, the people from ONS, the people who came in on my team, who just really worked together and created something quite special, and just had an awful lot of fun doing it as well. And that's me. I'm slightly disturbed by the size of my face, but do come over and have a chat. I'm still working at ONS. I'm always keen to hear from good people and work with good people. And if you're interested in everything that's behind that, a lot of the work we're doing is in Python, and I think that's pretty cool.
And thanks to all our Lightening talk speakers today. Through the benevolence of Daniela, we're going to... who feels that they could have gone on for 15 minutes more today? Who feels that they couldn't have gone on for 15 minutes more today? Oh, okay. Well, we're gonna have a few... Tomorrow, the GitHub checked the schedule, because we're thinking of extending the schedule by 15 minutes tomorrow, just to squeeze in a few more Lightening talks. So who thinks that's a good idea? He thinks it's a bad idea. Okay, good. So we will reopen submissions for Lightning Talks tomorrow. So get your ideas head on and start thinking of some ideas. Right, so don't go anywhere, because there's very exciting notices coming. That's it. So thanks again to our Lightning Talk speakers. First notice.
So, good afternoon, conference. Ah, you didn't do it. So, the only public service announcement that I need to make is that the education team, we need to shift some gear from the Ferrier room, which is over there, to a room which is kind of over there, ready for the kids' day. And essentially, if but 10 people turn up, we will get this done in about 2 minutes, okay? So if you look at the back, you will see Ben with his hand up, and he's waving madly, and Carrie-Anne is pointing at him. So if you would like to help, and it will only take 5 minutes, follow Ben, and I'll see you in a minute. That's me.
Thanks, Nick. Last notices of the evening. The dinner will be here at 7:30. That's in the lower hall downstairs where we had coffee and lunch. But the bar will be open from 7:00, so you can come there, but yeah, you can be there a bit earlier. If you do leave this building, be aware there's an awful lot of stuff going on outside, not only the Roald Dahl celebrations, but apparently a broken gas main in the centre of Cardiff. So there's a whole lot of excitement out there for you, and it might take you a little bit longer to get back in than you expect. So just to be warned. We're back here at 9:00. Tomorrow morning, so be here nice and prompt, and don't overdo it tonight. Thank you so much for being here today, listening to the talks, and especially not just for being an audience who listens, but also being an audience that jumps up to help carry tables and move things around and asks, how can we help when there's something that needs to be done? So we're really grateful for that, and it makes us feel that this community is something that it's a pleasure to do things in. So really, thank you very much, all of you, for that. Thank you to all the speakers today, and to all the volunteers who have been running around all day long. Enjoy your evenings. We'll see you at the dinner if you're there, and we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks.